Amistad and Harper Audio present Trinity, a novel by Zelda Lockhart, performed by Lynnette R. Freeman. Prologue. When the black bodies have let go and the spirits exist, they are able to come to folks and tell them all of the mistakes made in the flesh and lessons learned after the flesh. They are able to know life without time, without the limitations of the body, the pains of the mind. But what good is all their knowing unless someone with hands, feet, flesh, and bone can make right what has for so long been wrong? I didn't know that's what I was being called to do. But by the time I was 6 years old, I knew that what I was experiencing about living and what other people were experiencing were different dimensions of remembering. I saw my great-great-grandmother's capture as she ran across the sun-hardened earth of the Congo, having been chased out of her village by white men just after pounding the cassava and plantain flour to make fufu and swatting the morning flies. The heel bones of her feet pounded on the hardened clay. She carried in her womb two precious things. One was the stories of every villager since the first tree sprouted from the first seed. The other precious thing she carried was the untamed, untainted seeds of her children. I knew the accessory to the perpetrator, the chief, the uncle, father, brother, son of the villagers who aided in her capture for some false promise of his people's prosperity to match the white man's. That temptation to collude with the enemy backfired like the clogged barrel of a musket, an explosion that diasporatized my kin, scattered them like pickup jacks all over the earth. The impact inverted his wishes for prosperity into a backward cascade of beating, raping, killing the woman with the womb as he tried to find his way out of his misery. I witnessed his first sin, to make crooked his pact with nature, to nurture, provide, and protect his women. His second sin was the compromise made to fight white men's enemies in order to restore his own honor. His third sin was also his blessing, to fertilize over and over the extended limbed chromosomes for the eyes, hands, and feet of me, who he would leave to fend for myself and everybody involved. Part 1. The Father. 1. Samson, Mississippi, 1939. It was Benny's 10th birthday. Lottie pinched him between her knees and cropped off the tower of hair that was overheating the top of his head. "Benny, be still." A cigarette hung from her pouty lips, hand rolled from the store but supplied by the fields around them. The dangling ember grew a balanced ash, an inch long, threatening to set his black wool naps on fire. When Benny was born, she was only 13 years old, so he did not know to talk to her in a string of yes ma'ams and no ma'ams. He called his mama by her first name.
"Ouch, Lottie, put that cigarette out before you burn my head."
The porch was a refuge from the sun. It was so hot that day. The birds panted on the low-lying maple branches. The heat did not deter baby Leonard. He played in the bare dirt of the yard, making mud of the used wash water, his skin and the earth the same tint of copper. The sky was a clear cornflower blue, except for one white cloud, comfort that passed over the three of them before it grew thin and evaporated.
"Be still, boy."
She snatched him in place and chuckled. Ain't nobody gonna burn your little pea head. More likely the bird's gonna set up shop if I don't chop this shit off. Like an older sister and little brother, they were so close that it didn't matter that she hadn't tied a kerchief to hold her breasts in place under her loose cotton dress. She was still gonna hold him close, where he could smell the warm womanhood of her body sweating in the heat. But at the same time, she would snatch at him and tease him like he was some meddlesome little pet. He laid his head back in her lap, and the two of them looked in each other's big round eyes.
Okay, boy, I'll put it out for a minute. Can't smoke my smokes for worrying about you and Leonard gonna have a complaint.
He tilted his head forward for her to cut the back. His question hung in the heat of the afternoon.
What you and old Daddy bumping around about last night?
He knew old Daddy whipped her with the strap that was for the money satchel in the same way that old Daddy whipped him. Her beatings were constant, where his only came when his chores were half done. But he didn't have to be trapped in the room with old Daddy at night. She always had welts on her smooth, creamy legs, some of them purple from a few days back, some of them red from last night. He knew the beatings were getting more frequent, but didn't know why, and didn't know the right thing to ask. She grabbed a fist of hair at the back of his head and turned his face up to hers.
Benjamin Lee, let me tell you something.
She pushed his head forward again.
Don't you never trap no woman in your house like she a cow who happened by your barn for shelter. Don't you never be that kind of man. Ouch,
he complained and put his hands on the back of his head. She smacked his hand back down and tilted his head onto her thigh to get the sideburns. He felt a twinge of shame for seeing her breast beneath her arm and wanting to crawl into the safety of her lap and suckle, the way she still did for Leonard, who was 3 years old now, but still in need of her food. One of her loose dark curls fell from under her head rag, and high above her, the wasp's nest that she knocked down every summer danced with the brown insects making their home. The next morning, the wide fan of late spring tobacco leaves made the dew sweet and heavy. For a change, old Daddy didn't come in with the gray, warm light of dawn to jerk Benny to his feet off the pallet. Instead, old Daddy was already with the mule in the vegetable field, tilling the soil for their table crops. Leonard sat next to Benny, tying a string onto the leg of a half-dead June bug, and the house was strangely quiet. Benny looked out the window, and there was the wash tub on the old tree stump, but she was not there. He pulled the worn overalls up over his discolored underpants and went out to the open room, but she wasn't at the pump doing dishes or putting wood in the stove for breakfast. The lump beneath the chicken bone cage of his chest squeezed tight, and like remembering a dream hours after waking, he remembered old Daddy's voice muffled in the middle of the night.
Lottie! Lottie, where you at, woman?
As the sun burned the dew and blackened fallen acorns, Benny walked to the chicken coop, fetched the warm eggs, set the birds out in the yard to peck, set his brother out in the yard to play, and waited at the door of the barn, just inside its gaping mouth where shade could offer him some comfort. This spot was a vantage point for watching his little brother in the yard. He could see down the road when she returned, or see off toward the fields if old Daddy came, wondering why he hadn't come to hold the mule steady. The two cows behind him watched over the black naps of his head where sweat crept from beneath his hairline, their massive bodies quiet, except their synchronized breathing. They were content in the shade of the barn, even though it was midday, and he had not relieved their sore teats with milking, then setting them out to graze. In that hot space that grew hotter with none of his chores tended to, he wished above the deafening pitch of cicadas that Lottie would just come home. He made up his mind sitting there in the opening of the leaning barn that he was going to help her with the laundry, the canning, help her keep up with whatever work she fell so behind on that old Daddy saw fit to beat her every day. Benny pinched his eyes shut against the sting of sweat and wished that she was not where he knew she was, off getting what made her happy. She told him one day while she scrubbed up and down on the washboard,
"I got me a secret place I go. It makes me more money than old Daddy ever gonna make on this place. Gonna get us money to go to St. Louis."
He was captivated with her fantasy and churned the butter, glad to be in that best place he loved to be, wrapped in her attention.
"I slips my money off for Mr. Jennerette to save it for me. And I slips a little money in old Daddy's satchel sometimes after he been gambling, too."
Mr. Jennerette was a tall, cocoa-skinned man who was wide as the barn door. He looked like the young, happy version of old Daddy. Nobody knew by what means, but he owned the Swamp Bottom Tavern outright. Lottie bent down to the basket for the next piece of clothing. Her loose curls made a veil between the two of them.
"Did you hear me, Benny? I don't want my boys going hungry on account of their old Daddy can't catch up on things."
He didn't know anything about St. Louis, but he knew St. Louis was where his oldest brother James had gone. And Benny imagined cars and men in fancy hats, tall buildings and women strolling down the avenue like in the Easter parade. She snapped the water from a sheet before pinching it between the wooden pins and seemed to be talking to herself.
"Yep, I think he been figuring me out, though."
Benny knew how to put two and two together by the time he was 10. The oldest boy at school, Jasper Jackson, said the fast women went to make them some money down at the tavern. Benny figured his mother must have been very fast at doing something that people liked to pay good money for. He also knew from the way she looked around before confiding in him that if old Daddy found out, it would be the last thing done wrong. Benny imagined her at the money place of Mr. Jennerette's tavern. A man pounded out the blues on the piano. The fellow on the guitar slid his plow-worn fingers up and down the rusty strings. Grown-ups touched each other and giggled and seemed happy in the midst of what people called the depression. He danced to jiggity blues with her, was happy too, laughing out loud with her, until he heard old Daddy coming out of the swamp like an angry bear. He tore down the salty, weathered boards of the joint. Benny's imagination had slipped into dream, where he slept just inside the barn door, waiting for her to come home. The sun pushed the shade of the barn back and left him sitting in the sun, visible for old Daddy when he came to scold Benny about the chores. Deep in his sleep, he heard old Daddy's footsteps enter the barn. He heard the thunk of something, maybe a board against his head. He could hear old Diddy's voice, as if it was the song sung with the piano tune.
"Get your lazy ass up. You hear me, boy?"
Benny's small heart beat slow while he danced in the safety of the dream. Smell of gin and cigarettes on her breath, ribs poking through her cotton dress when she hugged him. The sound of gospel melodies with naughty words faded into scuffling feet on the dirt floor of the barn. Benny came conscious when he felt the braided leather of old Daddy's cowhide across his back and saw his gangly shadow cast against the walls when old Daddy's whip connected with the dry, unmothered skin on Benny's legs and arms. He tumbled and turned unnaturally, and the cows bowed their heads while they prayed and wept thick tears as he yelled for his mother.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.